players who have been around for a while, like Colin has, Hitmonpop is kind of a comfort Pokemon.
Absolutely.
It's the jack of all trades support Pokemon with Fake Out, with Intimidate, with access to some other support moves that just, you know, makes people feel comfortable using it.
Koji running a Mega Gardevoir team that actually reminds me of like the first Mega Gardevoir teams that came out once the Intimidate Incineroar was released, mm-hmm. and even before Incineroar was released, it was often paired with the Amoongus, with the Landers, with that Zapdos, and so yeah, it's a very strong core, one that we actually have not seen too much of in recent months, but Koji kind of sticking to his guns and using something that we've already seen a fair amount of, so the dynamic of this matchup will be interesting because there's speed control on both ends, right? Charizard and Cortana potentially could Tailwind, Cresselia could Trick Room, mm-hmm. and you basically have to worry about Trick Room with the Rhyperior on the team. And the other side, Gardevoir is a Pokemon that could potentially have Trick Room as well, so Colin might have to worry about the Trick Room Tailwind hybrid from Koji's end. So, should be a really fun one.
All right, well, we are about to get into game one here of Swiss Round 6 of the Pokemon Video Game World Championships in Nashville. Colin Heyer versus Koji Morimoto. Turn one, game one, Hitmontop and Tapu Koko will be Colin's leads of choice. They will be facing off against Landorus and Incineroar from Koji. So we're going to take a quick break here for three Intimidates to hit all of these Pokemon on the field.
We'll return to your daily scheduled DGC in about 30 seconds or so. But, you know, with these, it's still always important to see the way the abilities activate. So the Landorus Intimidate actually coming off before the Tapu Koko Intimidate, indicating what Landorus is faster than Tapu Koko, most likely Choice Scarfed, and then, of course, Incineroar is going last, so that Hitmontop is faster than Incineroar. So even though might seem like it doesn't matter too much, being revealing these abilities immediately goes a long way, so
yeah, really need to pay attention to that.
Absolutely. Now, this will be pretty interesting because Hitmontop does get a free opportunity to Fake Out. You could go for something like a Fake Out into the Landorus and maybe just swap out with the Tapu Koko, and we are going to see the Fake Out.
Well, it's going to be a Fake Out, but ooh, no switches. Hidden Power coming out from Tapu Koko will connect with the Landorus Therian form. That is Hidden Power Ice. Landorus goes down. So Colin able to get that free KO onto the Landorus. The U-turn coming out from Incineroar will allow Koji to protect his Incineroar and bring it back out later.
Excellent play there from Colin, a really hyper-aggressive play, but I think that's a testament to the kind of aggressive player he is in VGC. Often, Tapu Kokos nowadays don't carry that Hidden Power Ice, and even if they do, as we do see the Intimidates, so a lot of tracing Intimidates today with Gardevoirs, but the main point is that if you don't have a special attack boosting item, something like Life Orb or Choice Specs, then you might not necessarily knock out Landorus's even with Hidden Power Ice.
Yeah.
So maybe Colin was really confident of that double up because he has something like a Choice Specs or that Tapu Koko, knowing it's guaranteed to knock out the Landorus if it stays in. So it's a great turn one there from Colin, but now he is, of course, in a slightly more tricky position where Gardevoir gets a pretty free Hyper Voice off here, although you do have to worry about Wide Guard potentially from Hitmontop. I think Colin here probably is going to want to switch out, especially if he's got something like that Cresselia in the back. Although Cresselia, of course, does have to worry about Incineroar.
Yeah, absolutely. And now four Intimidates have hit that Hitmontop, which means that Hitmontop's not going to be dealing a whole lot of damage. So Colin will just switch out the Tapu Koko for Charizard and also switch out the Hitmontop for Kartana. Switching the Kartana into an Incineroar here, sometimes kind of risky, but Gardevoir just going to go ahead and Mega Evolve to boost up its stats.
This is a really big turn, though. If Koji calls this correctly and potentially gets a knockout and does half damage to the other, that could be huge. Kartana, very risky to switch into, but Incineroar opts not to go for a Flare Blitz, just goes for a Fake Out, and a Calm Mind comes out.
Mega Gardevoir just choosing to go for the Calm Mind, so Koji will be going for a more set up, slower version of the Gardevoir, not just going to be firing off Hyper Voices willy-nilly.
Yeah, and I think you do have to be really scared of Kartana still because of the fact that it potentially has Smart Strike or Z-move, where it just Leaf Blades do a lot of damage to Gardevoir. Even with the boost of Leaf Blade and a Heat Wave from the Kartana and Charizard, it probably still does around like 70% to that Gardevoir, if not more. So, yeah, the Calm Mind is kind of cute, but Koji could have potentially gotten a knockout that last swing. He's already behind. Gardevoir's really, really good against Tapu Koko and Hitmontop. It's going to have to take care of Charizard and Kartana right now.
Yeah.
Of course, the upside is you do have Incineroar, which can just launch a Flare Blitz into the Kartana, but we have seen a lot of more interesting Kartanas, either, you know, Z-move or substitute variants that have come up more recently. So I think Colin in a pretty commanding position still, despite that turn one, after that turn one, because he didn't really lose anything this last turn.
Charizard going to go ahead and Mega Evolve into Mega Charizard Y here. Brings out the Sun, Drought now, bringing the Harsh Sunlight onto the field.
Kartana may be interested in going for a substitute, but always scary to do that up against a Gardevoir whose Hyper Voice can just bypass that substitute entirely. Instead, overheat, a big overheat onto the Incineroar. With the Sun Boost, still not able to get 50% damage on that Incineroar, while Gardevoir will just be able to start firing off some Hyper Voices into both the Charizard and Kartana. Look at all of that damage after the Calm Mind, a critical hit onto Kartana, but will be enough to knock Kartana into Berry range to heal up most of that damage right back. But firing back with a Sacred Sword on to the Incineroar.
Is that enough?
Just barely enough to pick up the KO with a critical hit.
That could have been a big one, honestly. It's hard to say depending on how Collins Kartana is trained, but Incineroar is quite the bulky Pokemon.
And a beast boost now.
We saw that, first of all, the Kartana was slower than the Gardevoir, and then second of all, it did have the Pinch Berry, right? So as a result, it's clearly one of those that is bulkier, likes to stick around for a little bit longer. Incineroar surviving there could have been really huge because then you get a potential knockout onto Kartana and Charizard's at minus 2 special attack. We see Amoongus is the last one. Now Charizard's pretty free to switch out and switch back in. Kartana could just go for either a Leaf Blade or a substitute into Gardevoir.
The critical hit from the Gardevoir on the Hyper Voice may be able to, may mean that Kartana is in range for another Hyper Voice here, though, from the Gardevoir.
Right.
It'll be close, thanks to that Calm Mind boost.
Yeah, so we'll really have to see here, but yeah, Charizard's gonna swap out. No reason not to. You do so much damage to Gardevoir and Amoongus with the fire type attacks. And Collins basically played super aggressively this game, and he's gotten both turns to play out as perfectly as possible, where you get the knockout onto the Landers and then get the knockout onto Incineroar without taking any damage in return.
All right, Kartana will go ahead and detect this turn. Just wants to see what Koji's able to do here. Amoongus also going to protect this turn to make sure that it doesn't take any damage. Gardevoir's Hyper Voice will hit the protect and deal a lot of damage to that Hitmontop on the switch in. Cullen would really love to have Hitmontop stick around for Fake Out pressure, but it's just going to go down. Will allow him to bring back in the Charizard, should he choose to reset the special attack boost. Amoongus now no longer has that protect, will be open for Roastin.
Yeah, it's a big deal that the Amoongus did opt to protect that last turn. If he doesn't protect, then there's some mind games here, right, where it's like, okay, Koji could protect, does Colin go for an attack and then protect next turn? Now it's relatively safe where you can just launch a fire-type attack in. So Koji here probably has to go for a double protect, and he doesn't get it.
Doesn't get it.
Does Heat Wave hit? Yes.
Heat Wave hits both Pokemon in the sun, dealing so much damage to Amoongus, picks up the KO, and gets a burn onto Gardevoir just for good measure. A little bit of damage onto Gardevoir. Will now be on a timer. Can't just stall out with Calm Mind. Needs to be able to pick up KOs. Doesn't get it. Kartana hanging on with 2 hit points. That Leaf Blade onto Gardevoir plus the burn. More than enough damage for Colin to take game one.
Yeah, really great play from Colin this first game where it felt like he was just making the aggressive plays, and the 2 big knockouts onto the Landorus and the Incineroar were huge. I really wish we could have seen how much the Sacred Sword would have done without the critical hit, because that would have been really interesting. But really nice win there from Colin. Still kind of a scary endgame there. You know, if the Amoongus misses the, or sorry, if the Heat Wave misses the Amoongus, that could actually be pretty devastating. Although Kartana was mad, it did manage to hang on to the long run. It didn't matter, but in
just barely.
Right, in that turn, like, even though if you're Colin, you know, you've pretty much got this wrapped up, but you can still lose to a miss or a double protect potentially. Although I think it only came down to a miss in the end. So, you know, I think Koji here definitely needs to play around the Landers a little bit better. Landers is really good against Coco, Charizard, and Kartana. Able to intimidate the Kartana, able to get super effective attacks off against Charizard and Coco. So, yeah, I think now Koji knows, okay, he's got the Hidden Power Ice on Coco. It knocks me out, so how do I play around that?
Yeah, I think a lot of what Koji was bringing with his team, too, was sort of overcompensating for the threat of Trick Room on Colin's side with the Rhyperior and Cresselia combo. You know, that's why you would bring Amoongus, and Colin just accurately predicting that, going for the Charizard mode instead, able to just really easily take down a lot of those Pokemon that would otherwise be threats.
Absolutely. So I think Koji here could go with the same lead. If he does, then he'd probably just want to switch out turn one to get a free switch in, or probably just switch things completely up, maybe keep the Landers in the back. It is going to be Charizard and Hitmontop coming up this time around.
Charizard and Hitmontop are Colin's leads for game two now of Swiss round 6. Up against Incineroar and Zapdos on Koji's side. So only a couple of intimidates this time around. We're going to get into the action a little bit quicker. We do see all of these Pokemon getting their stat drops, exerting their pressure, and just sort of Charizard's getting ready to activate its ability.
Yeah, Koji this time around does start in with Thunderbolt on Charizard. It doesn't look like there's... You do have to worry, however, about Fake Out and Overheat, so Colin here could opt to Fake Out the Incineroar, maybe hope to just snipe the Zapdos with an Overheat, but Zapdos, it is a pretty special defensive Pokemon, potentially can survive that. So we'll see where Colin opts to Fake Out, if he even chooses to do so.
Well, just going to go ahead and Mega Evolve that Charizard right now, get the Sun out onto the field, boost up any of Charizard's options, and make sure that if Colin needs to, he does have the ability to go for those nukes like Overheat. Fake Out onto Zapdos, will deal a little bit of damage. Incineroar also faking out the Charizard though, so both players just trading Fake Outs, trading flinches, and now we're into turn two.
Yeah, so nothing too exciting there, although I do believe we
saw
the Charizard flinch after the Zapdos, I think, so that confirms Zapdos is faster. That could be a big deal because Zapdos, if it's running a Z-move, which a lot of the variants of this Gardevoir team earlier on in the season had, then it could potentially just one-shot the Charizard, and the Sun is up, so Flurbus would do a lot, but it looks like Colin doesn't want to risk it, ends up bringing Tapu Koko to potentially take an Electric-type attack.
Yeah, going to take an Electric-type attack, but also boosting Electric-type attacks with that Electric Surge terrain that's now on the field thanks to Tapu Koko. It is going to be the Z Crystal activating on Koji's side to boost up Zapdos' electric attacks. So Colin, making sure to switch in that Tapu Koko, will be boosting the power, but hopefully we'll be able to take that a little bit better than the Charizard.
Yeah, absolutely. And presumably it's going to target down the Koko slot. So still going to take a lot, but it is way
better than losing a Pokemon.
Exactly. Especially because now that Charizard isn't in threat of getting one shot because the Zapdos isn't boosted. Ooh, and a Stone Edge.
Interesting choice there. Stone Edge from Hitmontop, of course, only one level of intimidation means that it's still dealing a pretty good amount of damage to Zapdos. And Zapdos isn't a Pokemon that you usually see taking massive chunks of damage. So Stone Edge actually able to hit and deal a little bit of damage while Incineroar U-turns out of there.
Yeah, so opting not to go for a Flare Blitz, but I think Gardevoir is actually in a really good position right now where Koko can't really do too much.
Of any of them.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Koko can threaten with the potential of Thunderbolt, but then the Zapdos could just go for a Tailwind of its own. So I think the matchup is really interesting because it felt like Koji had a lot of good resources that first game, but just lost too many too quickly, whereas this time around, he's conserved it a little bit better. However, Zapdos, of course, has to worry about potentially getting knocked out by that Tapu Koko as well. So the main question this turn is, who does Tapu Koko target?
Yeah.
Do you just try to do a lot of damage to Gardevoir? Do you prevent the Tailwind? You'd think maybe prevent the Tailwind, but Zapdos here could potentially switch out into a Landers if there is in the back.
Yeah, absolutely. Koji in a much better position here in Game 2 than he had been in Game 1. We'll go ahead and Mega Evolve Gardevoir, hoping that the Hyper Voice will be enough to keep Colin in line, keep his Pokemon from going too crazy in this match. Tapu Koko's Thunderbolt, no protects, will target down Gardevoir, deals a good amount of damage, a little over 50%, while Koji is able to set up Tailwind from his Zapdos, making sure his Pokemon will be the fastest Pokemon in the game. Hyper Voice will be able to pick up the KO onto Tapu Koko, but not enough to pick up the KO onto Hitmontop. Critical hit helping that one out. Hitmontop able to eat its berry here, going to heal up a lot of that damage back and still able to move this turn.
And it is going to just opt for Stone Edge again.
Hits a second Stone Edge.
Nope. And Stone Edge, a cool move that we saw occasionally on Hitmontops in 2012 and 2013, specifically to hit things for super effective, like Volcarona, like Thunderous, which were common back then. But I think Koji's in a much better position this time around. He's got Tailwind up, he's got Gardevoir, which can spam Hyper Voice. You do have to worry about Wide Guard potentially, though, from that Hitmontop. That's, most Hitmontops will carry that, and that could completely turn the tides back into a favor. And there's a Wide Guard. Did Koji call it?
Wide Guard coming out from Hitmontop, trying to block a Heat Wave and Hyper Voice. Koji just going for autopilot mode with Heat Wave, trying to get the KOs onto both Pokemon, but actually splits the difference, goes for the Psyshock onto Hitmontop instead of another Hyper Voice. We'll be able to pick up the KO onto Hitmontop. Kartana now will be able to pick up the KO on Gardevoir with the Leaf Blade, but making sure that he didn't fall for the trap of using both spread moves, splitting the difference there. You know, if you're not going to Wide Guard, then I'm going to pick up two KOs. If you are going to Wide Guard, then at least pick up the one.
Yeah, but I still think Koji's actually in a pretty good position there because he made sure to not go for the Hyper Voice as well. Psyshock, the best play possible there. Blocks the Wide Guard now. You've got rid of the Wide Guard user.
Yep. And saved Landorus.
Yeah, Landorus and Zapdos against the Kartana and Charizard with Tailwind up. It's really a really good position here for Koji. So I think Colin here is probably going to hope for either a miss on either of these Pokemon, like a Heat Wave miss or a Rock type attack miss onto the Charizard, and probably snipe the Landorus with something like an Overheat, or even the Zapdos with Overheat, because if you snipe the Zapdos, then maybe Kartana can do with Landorus. Mm-hmm. But Colin definitely is not in the best position here. He is going to go for the Detect, so let's see what Koji goes for.
Yeah, Kartana is just going to Detect here. Landorus goes for Rock Tomb.
Does, is that enough?
It connects with Charizard. It's 4x super effective, and of course that's going to be enough. How dare you doubt Landorus and its Rock Tomb. Zapdos will go for the Heat Wave, though, into the Protect. Sunlight fades, so the Heat Wave is no longer boosted. But Koji Morimoto picking up that KO onto Charizard. It's just Kartana, not going to be able to do anything against the Zapdos and the Landorus, let alone the Incineroar in the back.
Yeah, I mean, Koji made a swap out in this game, right, where he brought Zapdos over Amoongus, and that clearly was the right decision. But that leads to a really interesting game three. Like you mentioned, he probably brought the Amoongus because he was really scared of the Trick Room component of Cresselia and Rhyperior in that first game. This time around, Colin didn't bring it. So going into game three, we got to ask, does Colin bring the Cresselia and Rhyperior? Does Koji bring the Amoongus in anticipation of that?
I mean, that's the thing, because if you're looking at these four Pokemon that Koji has right now, Cresselia, Rhyperior,
loves
these four Pokemon.
Exactly. The boosted Heat Wave there will not get the Kartana. This makes for a really exciting game three because we have all the pieces together now where both players have a lot of room for adjustment, and it's basically a guessing game of, does Colin go for the Cress right here and switch up a strategy completely, and does Koji once again bring the Amoongus in anticipation of that?
And it's all going to come down to this turn zero when they're in team preview.
Yeah.
Again, they both have six Pokemon, but they're only allowed to bring four each game. So now Colin has to think, you know, do I need to go to my Trick Room mode? Do I need to try to set up the Trick Room with Cresselia, bring out that Rhyperior?
Right.
Or am I scared of that Amoongus? Do I think Koji will go back to that well? I mean, if he goes for the Amoongus and if Colin plays the way he did in game one, he'll win game three. If he doesn't go for the Amoongus and Colin plays the way he played in game two, he's gonna lose.
Yeah, and I think that Zapdos being so good in that last game is such a big threat where I would say, like, I feel like Rhyperior really needs to come in more or less because, you know, Colin locked in immediately.
Yeah,
I feel like we see him do that.
He made a plan.
Yeah. So I would not be surprised to see Colin bring the Cresselia Rhyperior at all because it feels like he's just got not much of a game plan if he sticks with the same Pokemon, especially because we know the Zapdos is faster than the Charizard. Mm-hmm. So it obliterates the Charizard, obliterates the Kartana. Him on top really can't touch him, and then Coco can do some damage, but not enough in return. So we'll see if Colin adjusts, or maybe he's hoping, oh, Koji's just going to go back to Amoongus. But maybe Koji brings Zapdos and Amoongus this time around.
All right, well, here we go. Game three, Swiss round six here in Nashville. Again, the results of this game will not determine whether or not someone advances to day two, but it becomes so much easier for Colin if he wins this game, and so much easier for Koji if he wins this game. Ooh, big shakeups, Tapu Fini and Incineroar for Koji. And like you said, here it is, Cresselia and Rhyperior. If Colin's going to be on stream in a game three, he's going to go with what made him famous.
I love this adjustment by Koji, though. He actually ends up not bringing the Amoongus because you still have to worry about Tapu Koko, where you can't support grounded Pokemon. The electric terrain is up. So Tapu Fini here is kind of like the middle ground where it actually threatens Rhyperior so much, but it also still can be decent. Whereas in the first game, we saw Amoongus was absolutely useless once the Charizard came out. Mm-hmm. So this is a phenomenal lead here from Koji. I think that's the Cresselia Rhyperior is literally exactly what you want to see. You can potentially go for like fake out Calm Mind turn one, or just go for some damage immediately. Obviously, with Coco switching in, Fini is now threatened. So we'll see whether Koji gets a lot off this turn, but still great lead here for him.
Yeah, probably the best possible result for Koji.
Ooh.
Wow. Waterium Z coming out from Koji. Just going to use that Tapu Fini to get as much damage off as possible immediately. That's going to be an interesting amount of damage coming out.
Yeah, I suspect like Coco will be able to survive this, especially because his HP stat looks higher, but that's still so much damage there. You know, it's not a calm mind. Oh, it actually gets the knockout. Wow.
One hit KO, making that Tapu Koko look like a Rhyperior. Cresselia going to go ahead and flinch, not able to do anything this turn.
That's like the perfect turn there for Koji because like you'd actually rather knock out the Koko than the Rhyperior because it's like Rhyperior isn't going to be able to do too much in return. It's more or less forced to protect this turn as the Cresselia opts to go for something like a Trick Room. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Koji go for a switch out with the Incineroar out into something that he has in the back and maybe just go for a safe Muddy Water there to cover the option of Rhyperior attacking. Wow, no switch outs, no protects, nothing.
Yeah, no protects on Colin's side, leaving that Rhyperior open to a Muddy Water. It's super effective. The solid rock gets washed away. Incineroar also just going to go to use U-turn onto the Cresselia, dealing some more super effective damage. And Colin not able to make anything happen with the trick room here. Koji just a step ahead this entire third game.
Yeah, so Koji not switching, obviously, because he did have that U-turn possibility, but I'm shocked to see Colin not go for the protector. Maybe he was just really banking off, okay, I instantly get back into this game if you miss the muddy water and I Z move into the Tapu Fini, but it seems like that's a little bit risky to go for, where you know Koji's play is pretty much muddy water and get the Incineroar out of there for a free switch in, so then it can come back out for Intimidate.
Yeah, Colin gets his trick room up, but has no Pokemon left who can use trick room.
Yeah, Charizard not exactly the trick room sweeper you want to be using.
Yeah, Charizard getting a little bit betrayed by his friend Cresselia over there.
The upside, of course, is that the sun will make Muddy Water's damage output reduced, but yeah, this has been a pretty disastrous game for Colin, honestly. Incineroar can come right back in here as it will. Yep. Fini can go for a protect, and you can just fake out and get more damage off freely. Cresselia really not able to do anything, so it's pretty much down to Gardevoir to be all, or sorry, Charizard to be all four of Koji's Pokemon, and unfortunately, I just don't see it happening in this game. Colin is pretty much forced to rely on Heat Waves, but we know like he just has no way to really do damage against Incineroar right now.
Yeah, Incineroar is just going to be able to easily wall any option that Charizard has. It's going to such a well-played game from Koji in this game three.
The lead was, like you said, turn zero.
Clearly won turn zero. Cresselia trying to give Charizard a round of applause to make it feel a little bit better. Gets in the void. He's going to need a few of those. Muddy Water will connect onto Cresselia, though, so it's going to deal a little bit of damage. Activates the Citrus Berry, actually. Just enough damage to activate the Citrus Berry.
I feel like I'm watching 2013 now.
And Heat Wave coming out from Charizard connects with both the Tapu Fini and the Incineroar.
Oh, my goodness.
Actually deals some decent damage
there. But, you know, it still doesn't even chunk it under half. I think if you saw both go under half, you'd be like, oh, gosh, maybe I can do this. But,
I mean,
Koji is just going for the absolute safest plays right now. You know Gardevoir, or sorry, Cresselia is not going to do any damage. Yep. If you stall out the Sun turn soon enough, and we don't even see a helping hand this time around. So just going for the chip damage onto Fini with the Psy Shock. Just a fair amount.
Good amount of damage. Keeps it above any kind of, we already saw the Waterium Z on that. So it does actually a pretty good amount of damage with that Psy Shock. The Flare Blitz not dealing a lot of damage back to, or not dealing a lot of damage to itself with that. Cresselia avoids the Muddy Water this time, but connects on Charizard, the important Pokemon from Tapu Fini. Will be able to deal a little bit of damage, so one more Heat Wave coming out from Charizard. Will be able to pick up the KO onto Tapu Fini, deal some good damage back to Incineroar. Probably not in range to pick up another KO, though. We'll be able to hit it into the berry range instead.
I think Colin has played this as well as he could have. Koji had the opportunity to potentially knock out that Cresselia last turn just to make it like a 2v1 battle. But Trick Room is still up, and Cresselia is not really doing much. So,
ooh, Gardevoir Trace Drought.
unfortunately, I don't think that actually refreshes it. So I think Koji is still in the clear here. Now, the fact that Incineroar doesn't have its berry activated actually makes this pretty interesting. Helping Hand Heat Wave actually will knock it out, but I suspect Gardevoir will be able to survive that. But Colin has put himself in a position where he could potentially crit to win the game. However, he still needs to stall out Trick Room this turn.
Needs to keep Cresselia up and also protect both the Cresselia and the Charizard.
Right, so if Cresselia doesn't have Protect, you just go for a Hyper Voice and a Flare Blitz. Cresselia goes down and then the game is pretty much over. So most Cresselias don't have Protect and it doesn't look like it's going to go for it. So that should seal.
Actually, the Flare Blitz went into the Protect onto Charizard. So Hyper Voice will connect with Cresselia here. May be able to make something happen after Trick Room ends.
I am really surprised that the Flare Blitz went into Charizard there. Maybe Koji was worried that Hyper Voice wouldn't do enough damage, but the thing is, if you get that Flare Blitz off, you actually your berry back up. Mm-hmm. So I believe it hasn't taken its berry yet, but the thing is, Sun is slowly expiring. Trick Room is over. I mean, you still need a crit, I think, to knock out the Gardevoir anyway. Koji still knows that he has the tools probably to win this one, especially because he still has another Pokemon in the back. If it's that Landers, you know, that pretty much seals it up. But I think Colin needs the hope for a helping hand Heat Wave crit here onto the Gardevoir.
Yep, here
we go.
Is. That's the Heat Wave.
All right, it hits. Is it going to crit? Is it going to knock out?
Oh, Gardevoir is not having any of it. Easily taking that Heat Wave. Would have needed that crit, not getting it. Hyper Voice will connect with Charizard and Cresselia. Picks up the KO. Cresselia hanging on at 18 hit points. That's going to be game for Koji Morimoto.
Yeah, and it's surprising like he opted to Hyper Voice this time. Like if he was so worried the first time around, maybe he should have just Psy Shock. But the fact that Landers in the back was, Koji was probably just so comfortable with this position where he's like, okay, like I've got this in the bag regardless. And it really does seem like the case. So masterful adjustment there. That was the perfect lead there for Koji, calling Collins Cresselia right here lead and winning pretty much after turn After turn one, it already was so hard for Call to win because the Tapu Fini was already difficult to deal with, and then knocking out Rhyperior means that you have no Trick Room Sweeper. So the game was instantly over, I'd say, after the two turns, but Colin at least gave a fight to do his best to get back into it.
Yeah, lost both the Rhyperior and the Tapu Koko so early on. Set up Trick Room with only his fast Pokemon out. Koji Morimoto doing an incredible job to, you know, beat Colin at his own game. Just being a couple of, it just feels like he was a couple of turns ahead of Colin that entire opening.
Yeah, absolutely.